Good morning.
Good morning.
We're going to get started. Thank you all for coming today. We have a really special guest speaker today. Travels all around. He gets a lot of stuff done. He could be three people. So we're very fortunate to have him here today.
I'm a clone.
He said he's a clone. He admits it. Okay. Dr. Sacoby Wilson. He's the director of the Community Engagement, Environmental Justice, and Health at the School of Public Health, University of Maryland, College Park. Okay, he is associate professor with the Maryland Institute for Applied Environmental Health and Department of Epidemiology and Biostatistics at the School of Public Health. And he has over 15 years of experience as an environmental health scientist in a number of areas, including exposure science, environmental justice, environmental health disparities, air and water quality analysis, the built environment, climate change, community resiliency, and sustainability. He has a BS degree in biology, ecotoxicology, with a minor in environmental science from Alabama Agriculture and Mechanical University in 1998, and he received training in environmental health in the Department of Environmental Sciences and Engineering at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Dr. Wilson received his Master of Science degree in 2000 and his PhD in 2005 from the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. I give you Dr. Sacoby Wilson.
Thank you. So, great to be here. I have some slides I'm going to share. Really, I'm going to focus on more probably on the environmental justice framework today. I think what's important is, in this presentation, I'll focus in on Prince George's County, but I'm going to start out kind of giving you an overview. Some of you may be redundant, but just talk about environmental justice, why it's important, issues in the county, and some tools that are maybe useful tools for us to help advance the environmental justice agenda and address environmental injustice in the county. So I just need to move forward. Keyboard, yeah. So if you think about the environmental justice movement, and these glasses don't stay on my ears, right? Environmental justice movement, it really started in 1492. So y'all can chew on that for a quick second. But if you want to think about contemporary environmental justice, you can really look at Dr. King's work. You know, it was the 5th anniversary assassination in April 4th. And you think about Dr. King's work with the sanitation workers in Memphis. And that work is important because it was the intersection of looking at issues of labor, environmental exposures, public health. You had, I think it was a young lady who died in one of the landfills in Memphis. And so his work, is, in many ways, Dr. King is the grandfather of the environmental justice movement. And if you think about the environmental justice movement, why is it important? It's the child of the civil rights movement. It's the child, basically, so the merger of the environmental movement and the civil rights movement. So if you think about the history of this movement, it continues. It's a continuation of the civil rights movement. So it's a movement that focuses in on how some communities, due to race, ethnicity, due to class, due to educational status, due to geography, are overburdened by environmental hazards and locally wanted land uses, noxious land uses. So that could be chemical plants, coal-fired power plants, gas-fired power plants, incinerators, landfills, etc. And so that differential impact can lead to differential exposure issues and differential health outcomes. But there's a huge social justice component to this movement. So if you think about human rights as like a huge ocean, the environmental justice movement is a river that connects to that ocean. Civil rights movement is a river that connects to that ocean. Environmental movement, women's suffrage movement, reproductive rights movements, all social movements are really connected to that ocean, which is the human rights movement, okay? And so, I'd like to talk about how with his work in Memphis, you had black men walking around with signs saying, I am a man. Because they were being treated less than human. So I think that's very relevant to our politics of today and what's going on in the U.S. because, yes, things have changed, but things have also stayed the same. So I am a man. I am human. I have humanity. So reason why I bring that point up is you have these issues about walking while black, Starbucking while black, being while black, moving in while black, IHOPing while black, selling new purses while black, at the pool while black, sleeping in the dorm while black, flying while black. Okay? So these issues are important. Using coupons at Dollar General, CVS, while black. So you have structural racism that's embedded in a lot of our economic, housing, transportation policies. But you see these examples of individuals and how they're treated, which is a symptom of a larger problem. Okay, so environmental justice reflects, is trying to fight against that, both the structural part of it and how our decisions, our actions, our practices can lead to this differential burden of hazards. In many cases, the people who are most impacted, their voices are not heard in the process. You can go back to Warren County. So if you think about the movement, you look at Dr. Bullitt's work first in Houston, Texas. I usually have some slides about Houston. I bring in Hurricane Harvey, but the reason why Houston is relevant, since we're talking about planning, what's the only major city in the U.S. that doesn't have comprehensive zoning planning?
Houston.
So what you saw happen with Harvey is due to partly to man-made decisions. What we saw happen in Houston 2 years ago with the 500-year flood events, right? This is a Bowie flood event, is due partially to man-made decisions about how to do development. You have a lot of impervious surfaces in Houston. So you know if there's nowhere for the water to go, what is it gonna do, right? It's gonna flood. So that's a huge part of why you have to look at both the built systems and the social systems and our natural systems, and Houston is a great example of that. So some of the first work on environmental racism was done by Dr. Bullard, found that all the landfills were being built in Houston in the 70s were built in primary black communities, regardless of income. So a lot of cases, a lot of times we try to, you know, like I say, it's all about income and economics. Race was the most dominant factor, okay? Landfill, some of you may recognize Benjamin Davis. So you think about the fight in Warren County, it was fighting against a PCB, polychlorinated biphenyl landfill being brought into Warren County. So those of you who drive down 85, what's the first county you drive through when you cross the border? Warren County. Sometimes it's a big, I don't know, for those of you who haven't driven it recently, there used to be a big tree that would block the sign, right? You know the big tree. Now they do construction work, I think the tree is gone. Because you see there's a lot of construction. So those of you who drive out of North Carolina, you know about the construction of the roads, but it's usually a big tree that blocks that sign. But that's the first county that you drive through. And the thing about why this is important, this is really where we talk about the birthplace of environmental justice. You have folks who laid across the road to stop these trucks with contaminated dirt from going to Warren County. Warren County is a primarily black, poor community on well water. We know that all landfills eventually leak, right? And so they actually didn't even follow, EPA didn't follow its own procedures when it came to the siting of the landfill and also the construction of the landfill. So this is part, reason why I want to bring up this history, because these things that are happening, that happened then, are still happening today. This is weird, trying to TV slides, okay. So I like to, let me speak, I'm kind of, as Fatima said, I've got three jobs, so three people, so I'm kind of tired, so I need to get my energy up. But hopefully I'll get my energy up for y'all. So this first definition of environmental justice, I call it the kumbaya definition. This is the EPA's definition. So it's the fair treatment and meaningful involvement of all people regardless of race, ethnicity, and culture in regards to, you know, development, implementation, and enforcement of environmental laws and regulations. That's great. We know we want to protect everyone, right? But we know with environmental injustice, everyone has not been protected. People have disproportionately impacted. So I call this the, what's the comedian said, his partner, someone said, do you love me? And the comedian responded, I love everybody. That's the I love everybody definition. We want to protect everybody, or it's the Black Lives Matter. We know that all lives matter, but Black Lives Matter. If they did matter, we wouldn't have these issues that we had. All the fill in the blanks while black that I just said a few minutes ago, okay? The second definition is a definition that was coined by Dr. Bunyan Bryant at University of Michigan. So he was probably one of the first environmental justice researchers with Dr. Bullard, and it's EJ is served, environmental justice served, when people realize the highest potential without experiencing the isms, fill in the blank, decent pay and safe jobs, quality schools and recreation, decent housing, adequate health care, democratic decision making. If you go back to these, we're talking about social determinants of health, for those of you who understand public health, right? So the reason why I think this is important and bring up this social determinants of health frame into this discussion, planning was part of public health when it started. John Snow, right? Mapping. Think about Du Bois. The fathers, actually, so I need to step back. 1492, then Du Bois, then Dr. King, if I'm going to do it right. If you think about Du Bois' work in Philadelphia, GIS, think of all the maps he did. I mean, that was with block assessments. That he has to be the great-grandfather. Dr. King is the grandfather. He's the great-grandfather, and Dr. Bull is the father. I know there's a lot of dudes, so I might need to fix that. Sorry, I need to fix that. I realize that. But when you get, so we're talking about social determinants of health. So planning and public health, early 20th century, sanitation movement, y'all. What happened? Planning and public health were integrated. So we're talking about this democratic decision making and personal empowerment, communities free of violence, drugs, and poverty. So, Dr. Wilson, what does that have to do with informal justice? Your environment is where you live, where you work, where you play, where you pray, where you learn. Okay? That's what your environment is. Culture and biodiversity are revered. So a lot of times when you think about biodiversity, maybe I'm just putting things, thoughts into your head. Maybe the first thing you think about is thinking about polar bears. Polar bears are important. Biodiversity also is talking about people. People, right? Let's not forget about the people that live in these communities that we're talking about. So environmental racism, I'm not going to spend too much time on it, but that was coined by Dr. Benjamin Chavis when he was working in Warren County, trying to help the community members in Warren County fight against the landfill. And the reason why I think it's important to note, in the situation with Flint, Michigan, that to me is an example of environmental racism. In Flint, you have the intersection of race, class, place, vulnerability, hazards, and invisibility. I'm going to say it again. Race, class, place, vulnerability, hazards, and invisibility. What I mean by invisibility is because of the application of the emergency management law, the power of the people was taken away from the elected officials. They elected a mayor, they had town council reps, but the emergency managers came in, that stripped the power from people. Okay, so if you don't have political voice, if you don't have that kind of representation, that means you pull the power from folks when it came to local decision making. That's the same thing. You look at communities in Prince George's County or the state of Maryland that are unincorporated. Okay? Brandywine is represented in the room right now. Unincorporated. Similar issue. And then you also have another sister term to environmental racism, which is environmental classism. So Flint would be an example of environmental racism, environmental classism. Was it 6% of people of color, 4% people in poverty? Also the issue, I went to the University of Michigan for my postdoc. What happened in Flint wouldn't happen in Ann Arbor. Now we also have a PFAS issue right now in Michigan, right? So you have another water quality sort of dilemma, crisis happening in the state of Michigan. So let me skip this. So that's another, this one of the first books, Dump It in Dixie. So kind of just to reset what I said about environmental justice in the previous slide. So you think about being overburdened by hazards. That's sort of the typical frame when you think about environmental injustice. And it's when the communities are overburdened by these hazards, it could be heavily trafficked roadways, it could be incinerators, you know, it could be any type of pollution to the facility. It also could be industrial animal operations. So some of my work is on chicken farms and hog farms. So the Eastern Shore, for example. Also, these communities that tend to be overburdened by these hazards also tend to have a high concentration of psychosocial stressors. Okay, and what I'm saying is not just opinion. This is a body of scientific research that's shown this. Okay, and also these communities that are overburdened have more psychosocial stressors. Also, tend to have lack of access to health promoting infrastructure, salutogenic infrastructure, which is basically just a term that talks about health and wellness across all dimensions of the environment. So salutogenesis, it was a term coined by Antonovsky, I think in the 60s. So how do you promote health, salutogenesis? How do you promote health, wellness, well-being across all dimensions of the environment? So that's the built environment, natural environment, social environment, economic environment, political environment, and spiritual environment. So you think about planning, right? When you're trying to build, maintain community ecosystems, salutogenesis should be at the core of what we're doing, okay? And so if you think about Prince George's County, just one example, move beyond the environmental hazard angle, would be the fact that we have food insecurity in the county. We have a high number of fast food restaurants, you know, limited grocery stores. So if you think about the whole term, so what's the terms for that? Food what?
Deserts.
Food desert. What's the other term? So what's a food desert? When there's what? Basically nothing. Right? What's the other term?
Swamp.
So what's that? What does that mean?
Too many fast food restaurants.
So too much unhealthy food. So what's the, I mean, so think about from a public health perspective, we try not to always take a reductionist negative approach, right? A deficit approach to it. We try to take an asset-based approach. So what's the opposite of a food desert, a food swamp? See, everyone's think about, I think about food oasis, right? So food oasis. So District Heights recently lost its, what, grocery store, right? Was that 2 years ago? District Heights lost, so it was a Safeway was closed down? Okay, in Bowie, less than half a mile from my house, we're getting a Lido. I live in a food oasis. We're getting a Lido. I got all this, got Lido, got a, they built a, what, they got the Giants, and across the street, you got the new Harris Teeter, where I live. So if I have my bike and I rode my bike, I don't ride it like I should, I could go to multiple grocery stores less than a mile from my house. That's a food oasis. Now you have people in this county who have the opposite food landscape, right? We have some fast food restaurants, but we have higher quality, like Panera Bread and Chick-fil-A. Okay? So we have a few, but the interesting thing about food insecurity, and you think about salutogenic infrastructure and pathogenic. So I'm gonna call it the pathogenic infrastructure, right? So you want salutogenic would be what? Grocery stores, supermarkets, parks, green space, right? And having banks, community banks. What's the opposite of a community bank? Payday lender, quick loan, quick cash, pawn shop. You know. So you think about opposite of a grocery store, it would be fast food, liquor stores, convenience stores, right? And the thing is, you don't get one, they cluster. The fast food, the liquor, and the pawn shops, they tend to cluster. So it's not just it's a sign of food insecurity, it's also a sign of economic instability, right? So you can drive down Route 1, get into your little car, your visual in your head, you look, let's do a moped, your little moped. Drive down Route 1 and see how it changes, right? From neighborhood to neighborhood. And think if you're able to overlay that with census data. You will see trends and patterns as it relates to income, right? So we have a project right now where we're looking at, we're not only mapping all the grocery stores in Prince George's County, we're scoring all the grocery stores in Prince George's County using the Center for Livable Futures scoring methodology. And in a current project that we're doing this summer, we focused in on Greenbelt, Bladensburg, and also in Hyattsville. So Bladensburg has fewer stores compared to Hyattsville. Hyattsville overall has higher scoring average compared to Bladensburg. And both Bladensburg and Greenbelt have more closed stores. So it's not just the score. It's the type of store, convenience store versus grocery store, supermarket, and also more closed stores, okay? So we can use tools, mapping tools like that, to see where we have grocery stores, what's the quality of the store, and where we need to target to invest to build more stores. That's just a quick example. I wanted to, again, Fatima said I had like 50 minutes. I'm talking slower than normal because I'm tired. So those of you who know me know I talk faster than this, I have more energy, so I apologize again. I'm trying to get the energy up. I just want to touch upon quickly, you know, out of this, so you have this social movement, right, environmental justice movement. Now, I'm an academic, so I'm part of sort of the research arm of the movement, right? I'm also a researcher advocate, okay? Now, when you get back to the sort of the movement from an activist standpoint, you have what we call the 17 principles of environmental justice. So this is like the Magna Carta, you know, the charter, you know, the framework, the EJ Bible for me, right? Okay? And so the reason why I want to highlight these, because we talk about environmental justice, people think, well, you're just talking about, you know, pollution, or you're not talking about the environment. The environmental justice movement, the reason why it's so powerful and this framework is so powerful, we're talking about both ecological environment and man-made environments, okay? Look at principle one. Affirms the sacredness of Mother Earth, ecological unity, and the interdependence of all species. Principle two, mutual respect and justice for all peoples. So you bring discrimination here. Principle three, you see renewable resources, a sustainable planet. So environmental justice is talking about sustainability. Environmental justice is talking about conservation. It's also talking about people, social justice. You know, principle five is very important. Environmental self-determination of all peoples. Okay? So what's important about these principles, community members speak with their own voice. But you look at principle 12, rural cities and rural areas in balance with nature. So how do we build healthy community ecosystems? I mean, those of you who study know urban ecology, right? Those of you who are in architecture, those of you who have degrees in regional city planning. These things, this isn't, you're doing, to me, you're doing environmental justice work, okay? Principle 17, consume as little Mother Earth's resource and to produce as little waste. So this principle is saying, we don't support incineration, right? Zero waste is this principle. Change our lifestyles. Ensure the health and the natural world for the present and future generations. Again, sustainability, but not just sustainability, we're talking about ecological sustainability. You're talking about sustainability, economic sustainability, and also social sustainability. So we think about the health impact. So when you have this differential burden of hazards, it can lead to different exposure to pollutants. Some pollutants of concern, you know, lead. You think about particular matter, I'll come back around the particular matter. Again, if you live in a community that has a lot of traffic, you're going to be exposed to combustion byproducts. And the thing, within the environmental justice frame, the reason why it's important is, if I live in a community that has multiple roads coming through my neighborhood, right, and you're building a new roadway, wouldn't it be important to do a health impact assessment to understand the current burden of pollution in my community? So what are combustion byproducts when you burn fossil fuels? Particulate matter, PM2.5, PM10, right? So 10 microns, 2.5 microns. You have nitrogen oxides, sulfur dioxide, okay? You also have volatile organic compounds. You have polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. You have metals that are also released, think about your braking, and you know, the brake dust, okay? You have black carbon, you have diesel particulates, you have a lot of truck traffic. So you have all those pollutants in someone's community. So when you have those roadways come through people's communities, not only are the communities, the natural ecosystems used as a sink for pollution, but people's bodies are used as a sink for pollution. That's why it's important to have public health frame when we do development and planning, to understand what are the implications of this. You have mothers who are pregnant. You have a transfer across the placenta exposure to those pollutants. If someone's breastfeeding, you can expose a child through breast milk to those contaminants. Children are going to be born with higher body burden of contaminants who live in those kind of communities. So let's break this down from exposure science perspective. If you have a community that has a lot of these hazards, right? So again, stationary sources. You got a concrete plant. You got an incinerator. You got mobile source pollution, right, coming through. You have multiple chemicals that you've been exposed to. Chemical mixtures, people. Chemical mixtures. Exposed to air, water, and soil. Multiple routes of exposure, right? Inhalation, ingestion, drum exposure. And then those chemicals target different organ systems, either individually or as mixtures. And then it could be different effects, added effects, synergistic effects, multiplicative effects. So what I want to say is, even I just made that sound really good, I know what I'm talking about, mostly. Our science cannot keep up with the exposures. Now, I'm gonna be honest with you about that. Our science is not keeping up with exposures. So we make decisions on building new facilities. We have to understand the additional load, the aggregate impacts, the cumulative impacts of those facilities in that community. That's why there has to be more, even though the science is not keeping, let's use the science that we have. So if you step back and look at the example I'm talking about with highways and traffic, I mean, look, name all the 95s we have. This is a group exercise. 95, 295, 295, 4, 395, the 70s, right? So you got a lot, so that's a lot of pollution that's going through people's neighborhoods. Okay, so that's just one example. And so those pollutants, and before I jump to the health outcomes, let's think about lead real quick. Why is lead so important? There's no safe level of exposure to lead. There's no, any exposure is dangerous. So the reason why it's so important is children who live in these communities could be impacted by lead exposure. Now you say, Dr. Wilson, we got a lot of gasoline, that's correct, we got a lot of paint, but we still have, in our state of Maryland, if you live in older housing stock, potentially could be exposed to lead. And we know we have hot spots with older housing stock in Allegheny County, and also what city? Baltimore City, okay? So that's part of, for the whole Freddie Gray story, that's part of his story. Not what happened to him in his later life, but what happened to him in his early life, lead exposure, okay? So if you're exposed to lead, it's a neurocognitive, a neurological toxicant, okay? So I like to say, how can we put America first if we don't put our children first? So that's a sensitive window susceptibility for children. So we have an issue with lead in the state of Maryland when it comes to schools, drinking water, right? That parallels some of what happened with Flint. But when you think about the built environment, school environments, the fact that we're spending more money on bottled water in our schools, districts, instead of actually fixing the problem, which is eliminating the lead pipes, that's a big issue. And so children, when it comes to lead, they have, their lungs are still developing. You think about exposure in general, lungs are still developing. They have higher inhalation rates than adults do. They also, it takes lower doses to impact them. And then for children, the blood-brain barrier doesn't solidify until age 10. So when I say time-wise, sensitive one susceptibility, so it's easier for lead and other toxicants to cross into the brain. So particulate matter is quite dangerous when you think about this issue, because things could absorb to particulate matter. So it can get to the circulatory system and bring toxicants like lead to the brain of a child. Okay, so I just want to highlight, like, that's a real life example. And another angle when you think about children, we have a lot of children of color who disproportionately ride school buses. Why is that relevant, Dr. Wilson? Well, they could be exposed to pollutants that can impact their health and their educational outcomes. So they could be exposed to diesel particulates while on the bus, they can be exposed to it while walking by the bus, and because of intrusion, if you don't have good HVAC systems, they can have some of that diesel exhaust come inside of schools. So short-term exposure to diesel exhaust causes what? Impacts your concentration, impacts your coordination, and impacts your focus. So that's another angle to think about. It's also an environmental justice issue, okay? So let me speed up a little bit, because again, I'm talking too slow. I have too many slides, usually. Most of academics always have too many slides. So asthma, heart disease, obesity, and other health outcomes. So these burden disparities lead to exposure disparities, lead to risk disparities, can lead to health disparities. And I use the term community ecosystems. So, you know, these factors can create, you know, riskscapes, some more of a deficit, you know, sort of framing. But what we want to do is use planning development to create healthscapes, right? Create healthscapes. When I talk about the social determinants of health, how can we have health at the core of what we do? Not just diseases, but sustainability, quality of life, and community resiliency. And that's why I brought in the whole Houston example. Because, you know, hurricanes, so you got resiliency too, that's important. And we know in our own state with recent rains, flooding in Ellicott City, flooding we just had in Baltimore again recently. So that's an important issue to think about as well. So hopefully this was speaking more of your language, getting out the environmental health frames a little bit. So for me, the way you want to really try to get at addressing environmental injustice is really through equitable development. So I like to say that power, privilege, and isms are embedded in how we zone, plan, and develop. That's problematizing. So zoning, plan, and development is also the solution. And that's why I highlight the importance of planning and zoning in public health. Again, planning was a core element. It wasn't a separate component. It was a core element of public health in the early 20th century. How we built our cities, the fact that why did we start segregating land uses? We want to move some land uses away from people. Planning went into how we develop our sewer and water systems. And so I just want to highlight that, but one way to kind of address these issues is to use the equitable development framework, which looks at smart growth and the needs of underserved communities. And so you have, and why do you use this frame? If you focus on communities that are underserved, under-resourced, and vulnerable, it's a more effective use of your resources. And that helps you address those issues, which will benefit everyone else. So it's a better way to target resources. So this is a framework that we kind of developed. I had some students a few years ago who developed a report, which I can share with everybody, on environmental benefits districts. So some of you may know that concept. It's similar concept as eco districts. And so we just developed a report on how we could implement environmental benefits districts in Prince George's County in the state of Maryland. So this is a framework. I'm a gardener, so I love butterflies. So we wanted to bring the butterfly into play. So the whole idea is, you know, how can you use, so you have environmental injustice on this side, how can you get the environmental justice and flourishing communities on that side? So you want to increase salugens, which would, through equitable development, increasing equitable development. You want to reduce pathogens, which would lead to risk reduction. And so at its core, with the environmental benefits district components and within our own county, you have zoning and planning policy, the zoning rewrite, smart growth policies, the transformer neighborhood initiative. We got to do evaluation of that program first. When's that coming out? Okay, I'll stop. Okay, sorry. I was at the needle on that. I'm like, my thing is, as a scientist, you just can't have a program. You have to evaluate and know its impact. And what are the metrics? And I haven't seen a report on TNI yet. Have y'all seen the report? Okay, y'all have the same thing. I can say that. Y'all just, I'll say it. So economic enterprise zones also, and also health enterprise zones. So these are things we already have in that county that we can use to help with the implementation and targeting of environmental benefits districts. And then, remember I said before, when it comes to sustainability, let's put health promotion in the middle of sustainability. And so by doing this, by implementing this framework, you improve social determinants and you improve community sustainability. An example from California always has the best stuff when it comes to these issues. I always appreciate like climate change, oh, California, environmental justice. I know y'all may not know this, but a few years ago, California passed SB 1000. It was an environmental justice bill that requires all counties to have environmental justice in their comprehensive plans. We need an SB 1000 in Maryland, okay? So the whole idea is they have this tool, and I'll get into, and Fatima, keep me on time, because I have too many slides. But I just want to mention, they have a tool in California called Cal Enviro Screen. So some of you may be familiar with EPA's CEEJH screen, which is a geographic information system, GIS visualization tool, to basically screen for areas that may have environmental justice issues. So Cal Enviro Screen is a similar tool. It's a little bit more rigorous, and they actually provide a score. CEEJH screen does not provide a score. We have developed sort of a beta version of Cal Enviro Screen for the state of Maryland called Maryland CEEJH screen. And so the whole idea is you can use these mapping tools to map areas that may have high CEEJH risk scores. So you can see in this little figure, it shows you areas that have low scores to high scores. And then you can target investments. So think about how you can use community development block grants. We still have those, right?
A lot of them.
They still have them. Okay, just making sure. I know some things are changing right now. Community development block grants, TIFs, also any resources that come through the economic enterprise zones. I know the health enterprise zones was a novel idea, but I think it was a short-term funding, so we have to get some more funding for the state. But any resources like that can be invested. Clean Water Act 319 funds, right? Watershed restoration funds, and urban ecosystems. So those are some opportunities. So how can we kind of package these programs together to invest in areas that need these type of investments? I think part of the problem is you think about environmental justice from more of a social
a sociological perspective, you think about the whole issues with some of you in planning and architecture, y'all learned this in class, the whole the GI Bill, suburbanization movement, right, white flight. With white flight, you had divestment, disinvestment in urban cities, it moved out to suburbs. Now you have a lot of gentrification, so now everybody was, I wanna move back in the city. So you have, suburbanization is can create conditions of environmental justice, and gentrification also can create a condition of environmental justice. But my point, bringing it up, is the loss of resources. The loss of resources. So how can we make sure these areas that have lost these resources, that have been, that have had divestment, disinvestment, can get more investment, but it's equitable? We don't wanna do new development and do revitalization, or y'all remember from the early, what we call it, urban renewal? Mm-hmm. Urban renewal, and while urban renewal, we're gonna build a highway through your neighborhood. Durham, North Carolina, mm-hmm. right? Or, I know Durham well, y'all know other parts of Maryland, right?
We're gonna,
here's a highway. Let's do, y'all know about ecologic fragmentation, right? So this is metropolitan, it's a way to do fragmentation in neighborhoods. Let's build a highway, 2-lane, 3-lane, 4-lane, 5-lane. That's the quickest way to destroy a community. And you know that's happened in a lot of black communities across the country. So when we do revitalization now, let's not gentrify. Diversity is a good thing, but if people who only move in are able to benefit from it, then what you've done is led to differential impacts similar to what happened with suburbanization. Y'all get that? So differential impacts to suburbanization, differential impacts for gentrification. We want to make sure long-term residents benefit from it. Unfortunately, in D.C., a lot of people have been pushed out for that development, pushed it to Prince George County, and actually, a lot of folks can't even afford this county and moving to Charles County, right? So from a smart growth perspective, that's not actually smart growth, because what you're doing is you're expanding urban sprawl, and ex-urban sprawl, and rural sprawl. You're increasing commuting times, that means you're increasing the amount of pollution that's impacting local air quality, contributing to asthma. You increase the amount of time that people are sitting on their butts driving, right? So you contribute to obesity, diabetes, right? That's where public health, you bring health in, like, oh, let's not do that. Because we understand the negative health consequences. But if health is on the side, then you're gonna hear someone like me, Don Quixote, you know, speaking out when it's too late. I don't like being Don Quixote. You know, like, I don't want to be a little kooky. I mean, that's a good book though. Okay, so let me keep it moving. Okay, so one of the things that I do a lot of, how am I doing on time? I'm giving y'all, I mean, actually, for those of you who are interested in coming back to the university, I teach a grad level EJ environmental justice course and an undergrad level. You can be happy to sit in if you want to, because this is a lot of my lecture stuff, but this is like a whole semester. I'm giving you a little bit, it's condensed, so trying to give you too much. So a big part of what I do is citizen science and community engaged research. And I think the reason why I'm waking up a little bit, so because I'm talking fast, I can feel it. when I start talking fast, that means I'm up. Or I'm in robot mode. I always got robot mode. You know, y'all do robot mode. You do what you have to do and you go back to sleep. I'm going to do that after this. So community engagement is really, really important part of what I do. And the reason why it's important is you want to make sure you give people voice who may be impacted differentially by these decisions, right? So if you think about this continuum, you have outreach, consultation, involvement, participatory, and community-driven. So you think about outreach, it's unidirectional. You know, you may do a lot of outreach, but outreach to me can be ineffective. You just give information. You gotta give people a chance to provide feedback, respond to it. And it's not really it's not a relationship building either. It's kind of like, here you go, and you leave. Here you go, and you leave. Here you go. That's not helping to build capacity. That's not helping to empower. That's a word I like to use a lot. Not empower with an E-M, empower with an I-N. But I'll come back around that too. What does that mean? Again, I'm an academic. We like to, you know, change, make up new words, right? So you wanna think about consultation. There's more community involvement. So as you move from left to right, you have more community involvement. You also have more trust. You have more communication. So think about the best things in a relationship, right? You got trust. You got communication. You got respect, right? You got transparency. I always have to use a joke with my spouse. I like to go on a tangent. Like, we're in grad school. I was at UNC. She was long distance. She moved closer to be like, let's see if we're going to make this work. She's like, okay, cool. And we broke up in 2 months. Because that 3-year relationship of long distance was fantasy, right? And then also, there's a lot of trust there. She didn't know me as well. She told me, she's like, ooh, you're a little bit different than I thought. You when you hey, with flowers. When I drive along, this is Atlanta, right? So, yeah, that. Then February, and then we broke up. Then February 2005, I said, let's go to this park. Like, she looked at me like I was crazy. I said, will you marry me? She said, no. She said, no. Yeah. But then after 3 months, when I defended my PhD, oh, like, you can achieve a goal. She said, yes. So, the reason I bring that up is, relationships are important. When you're community engagement, it's all about relationships, right? It's all about relationships. So the best partnerships are built off of the best parts of relationships. So you have relationships with your peers, with your colleagues. You know about good relationships, and you know about bad relationships. And when you work with community doesn't want a summer fling. You know, summertime, you know me, then the summertime's over with, you go back, you don't know me anymore. That's not good, right? So you can't be doing helicopter work. You can't be doing extractive work. You have to be doing relationship building. And this is when it comes to like the science, like we talk about like doing science and working in a laboratory or doing exposure science, like we talk about mechanisms and stuff. To me, the hardest science to do is working with community, right? Working with community. And so when you get to over here, this is what we call community-based participatory research. This is mostly what I do. And also community-driven research. This is kind of like the gold standard, when the community drives the work themselves, right? I'm a technical expert, but the community doesn't need me, because the whole idea is when you work with communities, as I like to say, I live in Bowie. I live in a community that does not have environmental issues. We got a little bit of traffic, right? A little bit of traffic. But you might say, I'm in a food oasis. I got food, what's it, plotty with meatballs. I got food just falling in the sky, right? Just like that. And the thing is, I understand that's my context, and that's part of my privilege, right? Class privilege, okay? But when you work with community, you have to understand that folks are living these issues every day. They are the contextual experts. So my job is to bring in tools and resources and provide technical assistance and to help them navigate that so you get data that can be translated to action, whether it be decision-making, new policies, you know, raising awareness, empowerment, et cetera. So that's why I focus here. And I may start here doing outreach, but over time, I'm trying to get to a more long-term, you know, like we're really courting, right? We're gonna make this happen. And I'm working communities, one community I've been working in since 2007 in Charleston, South Carolina, was at University of South Carolina. I started working community in Medmen, North Carolina, around basic amenities, you know, highway building and lack of access to sewer water infrastructure. When I was a grad student, I still provide technical assistance to them. That's 20 years. Because a lot of this environmental injustice didn't just happen overnight, right? It happened over multiple decades. So it's gonna take time and work, but planning and zoning decisions can actually, if done well, can help cut through some of that. But it's also an enforcement, can be having all these exemptions, you know, in the code, right? We'll talk about that a little bit. Okay, and so we say, well, how do you connect to communities? How do you connect to communities? I'm gonna talk about it from my academic perspective, but this is relevant for you as planners. You know, what are the issues? What are the impacts? What are the opportunities for us to work together? How can it benefit? You know, what are the co-benefits? It just cannot benefit me as an academic. You know, I always like to talk about, you know, academics, we're in it for tenure. I got tenure, so that's good. Promotion, getting grants, papers published. It's published or perish. But you have to be transparent up front. Like, what's your why? Why are you here? Now, my why in working communities is to help the communities. But at the same time, to help the communities, I have to make sure that I can stay in my job, right? And so I got to be productive. So that has to be part of the win for me. But the win for community is address the problem. It's just not good enough to study the problem. We have enough data. We have to be doing actions, making changes that actually help mitigate, ameliorate the situation. And then you want to have partnerships. And the way I try to work with communities, I can almost connect to any community issue by talking about food, faith, family, health, and jobs. Food, faith, family, health, and jobs. I just, last week, I did a presentation for the Catholic Church, and they want to get more into racial justice and environmental justice work. So they brought me in to talk to some of their parishioners in D.C. And that's a relationship building I'm going to do to try to engage them to bring in this frame. But the way they're looking through it is through faith, and also through help, through family, faith and family, okay? So that to me is just a useful way. So you got two hands, you know. So you got the issues, impact, opportunities, benefits, partnerships, and food, faith, family, health, and jobs. Two hands. So just for you to remember that. And then do I have handbooks that go along with this? No. But it would be great to have more of a training guide, but we don't have that yet. But this is basically what I do. But we do have some information that you, if you're interested in it, and how do you do community engaged work, there's an organization called Community Campus Partnerships for Health. Community Campus Partnership Health, CCPH. I'm on the board of CCPH. I've been on the board for about 10 years. So I feel like a zombie. I want them to say, y'all got to kill me. I'm ready to go, get off the board. But it's an organization that really supports the use of community-based specific research partnerships to address social injustice issues and address health inequities. So a lot of, again, that's like, when it comes to public health, that's like one of the go-to organizations and trying to work with community on different health issues. Like I said, I do citizen science. I'm going to skip that. The thing about citizen science, old school citizen science is bird watching. Also, you know, water quality work. That's a lot of folks who are doing citizen science work now. I mean, and it's something about being a scientist. I have a PhD, right? All of you in this room can be a scientist, or maybe already a scientist. Because a lot of times we think about science, we always go to like the big S. Like, everybody's up in arms about climate change science, and uncertainty about that. I mean, I believe in climate change. I think hopefully people believe in climate change in the western part of this country, wildfires, eastern part of this country, flooding in Virginia, flooding in Baltimore, you know, flooding in Pennsylvania, right? But there's also the little S, the science that we use every day, and your cell phones that you have on you right now, and your microwave, your refrigerator, your car, that's all science. So I think we have to understand that science has played a major role in our lives, and it plays a role in our lives every day. Science goes in our clothing, shoes you wear, everything you use, science went into that. So I think I just want to say that this because science, everybody has access to science, has been accessing science, and maybe they didn't know they were accessing science. But what we try to do is work with communities and train them to be scientists, to collect their own data. So I'm going to show you a couple slides. A lot of my work is, again, around air pollution. And so there's a site called Aircasting where we have these low-cost, real-time sensors to measure particular matter. EPA EJ screen is in many ways is like a what we call PPGIS, public participatory GIS visualization tool. And then EPA has its own citizen science toolkit. If you want to learn more about different sensors that can be used to measure particular matter, volatile compounds, ozone, polycyclic hydrocarbons, also hazardous air pollutants, you can go to that site. And then SciStart is a really cool site. It's like a it has an online inventory of citizen science projects from people who are classifying galaxies. So then what we call mass contributory citizen science to more place-based citizen science where they may be doing infrastructure assessments. So if you are working with a community partner, for example, that has a flooding issue, infrastructure issue, they have apps and tools you can engage them in how to do those assessments at the local level. You can go to SciStarter.com. So just sort of as an aside, I'm working with, building a project with the NAACP right now. We're trying to get funding first for it, you know, we gotta get funding. But the whole idea is, as I said earlier, our science is not keeping up with exposures. Our monitoring and surveillance infrastructure is not keeping up with our industrial footprint, our industrial infrastructure. So the idea is to engage some of those social infrastructure in our communities to train those members to be citizen scientists to collect data on pollutants of concern in those communities. So it could be a particular matter. It could be looking at noise issues. It could be looking at light pollution and flooding. So the whole idea is to work with that infrastructure. So the partner we're trying to work with right now is the NAACP. I'm also trying to engage fraternities and sororities, my fraternity, my alpha, get them engaged. So how can we engage these groups that are highly involved in the communities, but bring these other issues that are part of the tapestry of the structural problems, right? It may be things they don't normally work on, but it's there. So the whole idea is how can we use citizen science and train people so they can turn their windshield wipers on, right? And they can see it better. They can connect to it. So if folks are doing education work with youth, you can do citizen science. If people are doing economic empowerment work, you can do citizen science, right? So it's all kinds of angles we connect citizen science to that work. And so that's what we're trying to do with those organizations. I keep turning around. Wait till the computer is over here. So I'm gonna get to this mapping. So I told you about the mapping tool. I want to show you that as well. Let me see. I'm gonna let that open and go back to PowerPoint. So this is a picture of the air beam. It's a real-time sensor that can measure a particular matter every 2 seconds. We've been using it in communities like Bladensburg. It also can measure humidity, temperature, and pressure. And through the app, you can get noise. So I'll show that data. Here's some of the screenshots. So if you're walking, you can walk and see your track. And so, of course, it's a chloropleth map. It's a color. So as the color changes, the more intense the color is, the higher the concentration or the higher the noise level. So in this case, we're talking about noise, but it also does this for PM. So generation one shows you, it only measures PM 2.5. The air beam generation two measures PM 10. It's the big stuff. Measures PM 2.5. Remember, PM 2.5 causes asthma attacks, causes elevated blood pressure, heart disease, stroke, Alzheimer's, and contributes to infant mortality rates, birth defects, cancer, and premature mortality, okay? And then you have PM1, 1 micron. That's the really small stuff. So it can get into target different organs like your liver, kidney, also your heart, your lungs, and again, as I said before, your brain. This sensor is called the Atmo tube. It measures total VOCs. So if you have an area that has a lot of traffic, again, remember VOCs are combustion byproduct. Also, you have stationary sources that emit VOCs. But it's really good for traffic, so we've been using this one as well. And both of them use to give you an air quality score, just like the y'all know about the AQI. So your ozone alert days, hey, it's red, don't go outside. We've had that recently, but now that we have rain this week, I think if you look at it, it will be green, because you had deposition. But when the temperature increases again, it's gonna probably be higher. AQI will be higher, right, commuter? And this thing is called the purple air. So the other ones are good for mobile monitoring. The purple air is good for stationary monitoring. So say it's plug and play. All of them use Wi-Fi, I think, and Bluetooth. The purple air, you can only use it, it has to be an Android-based phone or tablet. So that's the problem. The air beam. Only Android-based phone or tablet. The Apple tube, you can use Android-based or Apple. And this is just plug and play. You have to connect to Wi-Fi. And so the purple air is good for stationary monitoring. It can measure PM10, PM2.5, and PM1. It also gives you temperature, pressure, and humidity as well. So, and these sensors are giving data, real time every 2 seconds. The issue is they are not as accurate as the EPA federal reference method sensors. So what you would have to do if you use them, for example, around highly traffic areas, around maybe minor sources like concrete plants, or major sources like a gas fire, a coal fire power plant, you want to compare this sensor by doing co-location with a federal reference sensor and then get a calibration curve. So say it's 20% lower, than the reading is 20% lower than an EPA monitor. So you just do a calibration curve, so it will adjust the data. Okay, so that's one way to address this issue. But the great thing about these sensors, and the reason why I emphasize them in my work and emphasize them in communities that I'm trying to help, is we only have about 3 EPA federal reference method monitors in the region.
Oh, in nice forested areas.
They're in forested areas, so they're giving you more. So the reason why they do that is it's gonna give you more general. But the thing is, that data is not relevant for site-specific concerns. So from a scientific perspective, that's called exposure misclassification. What's being measured there is not what's been measured, what's happening at my house. But when you go through a permitting process, facilities, what happens is, well, we are in, the first they may say we're in attainment for PM, and you could be in attainment in the region, but locally, what is the PM level, right? And then you can say, well, because this area monitor is showing us that it's only 5 micrograms per meter cubed or PM, well, our contribution will not impact that much and lead to non-attainment. So when you say the county is an attainment or the average for the county is 5, what you're really saying is the average at that monitor is 5, but you're applying to the county. That's actually bad science, folks. So this is what I'm saying about being cautious about when you make decisions on new facilities that lead to new outputs pollution without really understanding the baseline sort of levels of these contaminants across the area. So since you don't have the monitoring networks, you need to add in monitoring networks so you actually have more accurate data when you go through the decision-making process around, okay, we're going to add this, we're going to get this facility a permit because we don't believe it's going to impact air quality. To make a decision, you actually have to have the data. So what I'm saying is, a lot of decision-making, in my opinion, has been made without actually having the right data. Not just the pollution data, but then also when it comes to baseline health, do you know what's the health status of the populations who are going to host these facilities, host these uses? Now, some of it is going to be more site-specific as a stationary source, but some of it may be more mobile. So you gotta have a network. So right now, we do not have a network of monitors that capture the exposure profiles of our residents in Prince George's County. Do y'all get that? So that's, again, what I'm saying. When you got to bring in environmental health, you got to bring in public health into the discussion. And so when communities complain about new facilities or permits, it's like, how's it going to impact my health? We're actually not collecting the data to answer those questions well. So when it comes to the staff reports, when you have to, as part of the staff report, you say you have to look at health, safety, and welfare, right? But in the actual process, you're not collecting the data to really inform where we are with health. So that's why it's important to have a health impact assessment as part of this process, okay? And you have to have an ordinance on the books and an ordinance that doesn't allow for exemptions for special exceptions, like the fly ash landfill in Brandywine, or like the MCO concrete batching plant in Bladensburg, okay? Those are just two examples. How am I doing on time? Should I speed it up a little bit?
You're fine. Yeah, speed up a little bit. We can go over a little bit.
Okay. So I just want to highlight a few examples. Curtis Bay, a really good example of environmental injustice, but, and why? So I talked about the three-legged stool, right? Overburden of hazards, psychosocial stresses, and then the infrastructure. And in a lot of cases, when you live in a community that have the disparities in burden, at least the disparities in exposure, leads to health disparities. So what you see in Curtis Bay, y'all know about Curtis Bay, it's a goods movement community. What I mean by goods movement? That's the port, right? So you got ships coming in, you got traffic, you got pollution, you got diesel trucks taking those goods off those ships, and you have a lot of peripheral industries. So what happens is, once you get one type of, you know, these hazard, one of these pollution sources, you get two, once you get two, you get three, once you get three, you get four, and you become kind of a dumping ground. So I would say Curtis Bay is a dumping ground. It's an risk rate. And so people who live in Curtis Bay, you see in the Baybrook area, you see higher mortality rates from heart disease compared to Maryland and the U.S., lung cancer disparities, and also mortality disparities as it relates to chronic lower respiratory disease. So this type of data is necessary to inform decision making. This is information we need, as I said before. That's why it's important to have really good health impact assessments done. So you have the kind of baseline data. Hey, our community already has health disparities. How will this new facility exacerbate that? How will it impact that? And then, okay, if this facility type is going to have emissions, is going to impact it, what facility we can bring in that won't have emissions? What industry can we bring in? If our goal is economic development, what are the types of facilities we can bring in that will not have a deleterious impact on human health because of the emissions from those facilities themselves or the truck traffic associated with those facilities? At one point in time, the zip code that hosts, that Curtis Bay zip code was the most toxic zip code in the country under toxicity inventory for air emissions, okay? Out of 9,000 zip codes. So because there's a lot of pollution sources in Curtis Bay. And remember I said, we talk a lot about criteria air pollutants, right? But beyond criteria air pollutants, there's a lot of hazardous air pollutants that have no standards, okay? There's no standard for black carbon. Black carbon is a major pollutant associated with diesel emissions, right? There's no standard for that. So what's important is, we're talking about TRI. These are things that they're required to report if it's above a threshold. But what about all those other pollutants? Remember I said this whole term about chemical mixtures and aggregate impacts. That's a lot of, so they've been exposed to a lot of things through the air. So inhalation, but remember I said before, that you can be exposed to multiple media, okay? And also, as you know from deposition, you know, fading transport, what goes up must come down. So the contaminants in the air can then contaminate the soil. So one project that I've been working on with a student in Baltimore is looking at proximity of environmental hazards to urban garden in Baltimore. That may be an issue of concern in Prince George's County because you're trying to address one issue, food insecurity. But if you have constant source pollution, whether it be stationary sources or mobile sources, what are we doing to make sure we don't create another issue? So are we using hoop houses? Are we using greenhouses? Are we using raised beds? That has to go through the process. So urban agriculture shit is a great solution. I am a farmer at the house, not a real farmer. And the people who know me know I talk about all my stuff. I'm growing sunflowers, I'm growing blueberries, blackberries. I have fight with squirrels and deer. You know, I got tomatoes. I have two Carolina Reapers. I'm not sure how that happened. And I also have a ghost pepper plant, right? So I'm getting all these tomatoes, I'm getting all these I'm picking blackberries like a half a quart a day, right? You know, I have a banana tree, a banana bush. Well, banana plant is like this big, not a tree. You know, I won't exaggerate, but this big. I also have two pineapples growing too. We'll see if they survive. But I want to have a food forest at my house, right? I want to have food forest. But urban ag is a solution for communities that do not have food security, but if they also have a lot of hazards, environmental hazards, we got to address that. We have to address that. So we have to think about that. And that's what we've been thinking about in the Consciousness Project in Baltimore. But as you know from Curtis Bay, you know, the power of one person, one person can lead to real change. So you know, you may not know Destiny Wofford. She's a high school student who got a community organized to fight against an incinerator being placed in a community, Engine Answers. Engine Answers was gonna be the largest trash incinerator in the country, okay? And she got a community organized. There's groups that helped out to provide technical assistance. We provide some technical assistance. And they were able to stop this incinerator. And what's the sort of egregious part of this story is the school district was going to buy energy from the incinerator, which is going to be less than 1 mile from the school. So they were able to use pressure to get the school district to break the contract and other entities to break the contract too. And then since the facility had a permit to construct, they had a time limit. They ran out of time. And the MDE pulled that permit. So it's a combination of things that worked out. And also,
this
is Curtis Bay.
Okay.
Curtis Bay in Baltimore, South Baltimore. So Brandywine, got some Brandywine reps in here. I talked about being unincorporated. The thing about being unincorporated is you don't have a mayor, you don't have a town council. So you may say, well, Dr. Wilson, we have county representatives. County representatives are in the interest of representing the county. Okay, decisions are being made, if you're unincorporated, particularly when it comes to economic development, any development that comes to the community, any tax revenue does not go to the unincorporated community. It goes to the county. So that's the thing about environmental injustice. It's not just about the differential impacts, it's the benefits. Like we host these land uses, right? And we're not getting the benefits. So why is Brandywine important to mention in the context of Prince George's County? Brandywine has a coal-fired power plant, has a gas-fired power plant under construction, another gas-fired power plant that's under review, I'll say that, under review. They have another power plant in close proximity, so within a 2.9-mile radius, there are three either built or proposed power plants. In a 13-mile radius, there are five either built or proposed power plants. I'm not done. Superfund site, slush lagoon, fly ash landfill, okay? You also had over 10 surface mining operations. You have a concrete plant, so surface mining, they're using explosives to get aggregate material for construction, okay? And you have about 3,500 diesel truck trips per day. Now, those of you know about Brandywine, oh my God, I'm gonna move to Brandywine, all those big houses, right? Brandywine is a classic example of environmental injustice because of the combination because of being unincorporated, and the number of hazards and the decision-making process that led to those facilities being built without real community input in the decision-making process. So here's a map that shows where Chalk Point is, the proposed Pandemonium site, and the North Key site that's under construction. Now you remember I talked about all those pollutants. Now of course there are gonna be stacks that stuff is gonna move far away, so it's just not gonna impact the local community, it's gonna impact other folks as well. But when you think about the type of pollutants. We talk about natural gas is like this transition fuel. Oh, it's so great environmentally. No, it isn't. It's gas. When you burn gas, what do you get? Combustion byproducts, folks. So it's easy for us to say who don't live there, oh, this is great for the environment and great for human health. If you live there, it's not great for that community. So that's why it's important when we make sure the community is most impacted is that the decision-making table at the beginning of the process and not at the end of the process when it's too late. So you have that, and then you see that the Mattawamon facility is close to the elementary school. So remember, how are we gonna put America first? We're gonna put our kids first. And what? And remember I talked about PM? PM is a very dangerous pollutant. There's other pollutants too. But we've done a lot of research on PM. We know how it impacts human health. And I went through like a litany of health effects of PM. And that's why it's so dangerous. And so it's so dangerous, but the only park in Brandywine is right near the fly ash landfill. How did that happen? Fly ash, right? PM2.5, PM10, PAH, as I mentioned before. You also have metals. You also have radioactive elements, too. You got kids running, playing, kicking balls, hitting balls, potentially falling down, and they're outside playing, higher inhalation rates, right? Remember I said lower doses have an impact on them. This is environmental justice. So how can we use, think about how can we use planning and zoning to address this issue? We shouldn't be providing a special exception to this fly ash landfill for another 10, 20 years. They should have been required to clean up the facility. It should be kept, it should be closed. You should not have a park by this fly ash landfill. Bladensburg. Here's a little map that shows some of the schools in the area near the, you know, Ernest Meyer concrete batching facility. You have this great resource, watershed. The park, you have a Kingdom Missionary Baptist Church. It was built in, I don't know, it's over 100 some years old. It's right near the concrete plant, historic black church, Bladensburg Elementary School, not that far away, less than a mile away. And now here's the block plant. Now when I think about high tech facility, this is not what I think of. When I see this, I think about Fred Sanford. Every time I see this, I think about Fred Sanford. I love myself, you know, Red Fox now. But I don't want this in my community. Right? This community, this facility has never had any air monitoring. This facility has never had any site assessment. So this facility was built before we had the EPA. So you don't know what's in the soil, you know, strata, right? We don't know what contaminants is there. So they're asking to get a special exception so they can build a concrete batching facility at the concrete block, or the concrete block facility. No, the batching facility at the concrete, they're doing concrete block now. And so the reason why I mention this example is, it's classified under Clean Air Act as a minor source. But if you have multiple minor sources, it's the aggregate impacts can still be negative impacts for environmental quality and negative impacts on human health. Under this, in our state code, this facility, because it's a minor source, they're not required under our state statute, state code, to do air monitoring. So you have a problem legally. So one of the problems, go back to the about environmental justice, equal enforcement of the law, sometimes we have bad laws. So at the state level and at the county level, so we have to fix this. Yes, we want development, but we want healthy, equitable development. That's what that framework, so you bring those equitable development principles into play. These type of, you can kind of walk through a certain questions. What's the issue? Is it equitable? What's the impact? What are the benefits? How can we do this better? That's why the environmental justice framework is important. And that's why, the equitable development framework is important. So you have aggregate stockpiles. Again, same thing with the fly ash landfill in this facility. What you can have? You can have fugitive dust emissions, windblown material, okay? You also have, a lot of big diesel trucks that come through. So remember I talked about black carbon, diesel particulates. So you can have particulate matter, other pollutants that can impact human health for folks who go to the church, and also for the workers. The workers are not wearing PPE. They're not wearing protective gear. Okay, they have this a lot of dust. They're not wearing protective gear. And so, and the church that's nearby, a lot of these diesel toxicants, they can cause cancer. Over 40 compounds cause cancer. But remember I said before about children on school buses. It's relevant here too. Impacts to coordination, concentration, focus. Acute exposures can lead to asthma and, you know, and respiratory problems. Okay? And so, you know, what we've done is in one of our projects, I have a grad student, Rosemary. She's done some monitoring, working with undergrad students to monitor their sites around the concrete plant. But also, as you know about Bladensburg, there's a lot of commuter traffic. And so it's about the concrete plant, industrial traffic, and commuter traffic. And just to show you a quick slide, now, these lines are not as important. These are old PM standards, both the daily and annual standard. But what's important is, and using the air beam, we found we got to levels almost around 200 micrograms per meter cubed. Now the current daily standard for PM is 35. The current annual standard is 12. Now this is just, you know, sort of a 30-minute. This is a 30-minute segment. So we monitor for 30 minutes. But think about if we had this monitoring every day for a full year and compared that data to the annual standard. Or basically over, say, a 3-day period, we monitor for 3 days for 24 hours to compare that data to a 24-hour. That's a lot of PM. Okay? That's a lot of PM. So what can we do? I wanted to, just real quickly, Fatima, how am I doing on time?
You're fine. You opened up an internet site. Did you want to go back to that?
Oh, no, this is just, oh. Oh yeah, the internet, yeah, so let me go back to that real quick. So, I'm gonna do two things real quick. So we, as I mentioned, as Fatima just mentioned, we developed this Maryland Environmental Justice Screening Tool, similar to Cal Environmental Screen, and similar to the EJ Screen, but it gives a score. So what we've been doing, we're developing a training guide. And it's taking some time. So we're developing a training guide. I just want to show y'all this briefly, where we're going to walk people through how to use the tool. And so we give screenshots, different layers that are in the tool. But what I want to do first, let me go here. So as part of this tool, we have subcategories, environmental exposures, environmental effects, sensitive populations, and socioeconomic factors. And basically, for each factor, each subcategory, it gets a score. And then there's an aggregate score for each subcategory, and it's an overall score. So what happens is you get a score from 0 to 100, and it's basically ranking you using percentiles. So how does this area, when it comes to rank, when EJ risk compared to other areas? So you can compare within the county, you can compare within the state, okay? And so what we want to be able to do is basically show people, sorry. So as I was just saying, EJ scores represent a percentile, meaning that if an area scores 0.92, as the EJ score higher than 90% of census tracts in the state or county, okay? So we can use this tool to compare, again, to different parts of the state or different parts of the county. In this actual guide right now, we focused in on Bladensburg and just got to show you real quick. So you can go to the tool. Sorry, this is scrolling too fast. You can zoom in to the area. It can give you scores. If you look at this map, maybe it's hard to see. But you'll see that the scores range from, again, 0 to 1. The highest, and we're doing, this is a quartile map. So you see areas that have high scores in the inner beltway, basically. Inner beltway. And then if you keep zooming. Oh, let me go back up. So you can do the overlay. So you can see the scores again. And you can look at it by counties. We're also trying to do scores at the legislative district level as well. So we have that. Keep going. And so this, as part of the walkthrough, what we're trying to do in this document is just to, again, give you sort of help you walk through how to use the tool. And so when it comes to some of the exposures, the variables that we have NADA, air toxic cancer risk, we have NADA, respiratory hazard risk index, these particular matter, we have particulate matter, we have ozone, traffic proximity and volume, lead paint indicator, and proximity to, I think, the risk sites. And what's interesting is, for this particular area, the reason why this score, part of the reason why this score is so high is because of traffic proximity and because of the NADA diesel exhaust. So remember I said there's a lot of commuter traffic, there's a lot of truck traffic. So that's going for Bladensburg, that's going to impact the score a lot, okay? For other parts of the county, it may be other sources that may impact the score. So if we did Brandywine, for example, you're going to probably see a high score,
but it may not be due to the same factors that you see in Bladesburg. Traffic will be a similar factor, but there'll be other factors that impact the score. And so when you look at those categories again, we have particulate matter, ozone, traffic proximity for exposure, pollution burden, environmental effects, we have lead paint, chemical accident facilities, hazardous waste sites, sensitive populations, we have things about folks with asthma, heart conditions, and infants with low birth weights, and population characteristics, that gets back to like your basic census data, right? Percent poverty, number of folks under 5, over 64, unemployed, linguistic isolation. I think it's quite relevant for Prince Edward County, since we have an increasing Latinx population and a growing Latinx population in the area. So let me see. So this is just the guide. And I mean, I don't even have a lot. I don't have time to really walk you through this. But when I want to switch to the tool. Fatima, what happened to it?
Maybe you were on Explorer.
Explorer?
Yeah. Oh.
Yeah. I don't see it. Mm-hmm. Got a lot of.
Was it in Chrome or in Explorer?
Okay, I don't see anything in Chrome. Okay, how did I get to it? Oh, let me go back to PowerPoint. I'll just go back to PowerPoint real quick. Sorry. And this, so I said this is beta mode. Because of the platform that we're using, right now we cannot render the whole state. So we really have to either focus on Prince George's County, surrounding counties, or Baltimore City, and so, you know, so the Baltimore MSA, or Prince George's County, surrounding counties, because we can't render the whole state. So part of that's why I said it's kind of a beta mode, or what's even the pre-beta, alpha, whatever. It's one of those modes. So we have to get more funding to get a new platform, so we can render the whole state. We also, at this time, we lost our IT staff for the tool. So one thing to think about when it comes to this tool for the state of Maryland and also for the county, we talked about the School of Public Health, and it takes time for it to come up. We talked about the School of Public Health being the home for this tool, but the home for this tool could also be a county agency. So it could be planning department, it could be, you know, Department of Environment. So that's an option, or it could be collaborative. I mean, we could kick in resources together to make sure that the tool is on the proper platform. We need to have IT staff. You gotta have someone who updates the tool, who does maintenance on the tool. We have to get a help guide that we're developing, but you know, we have a help guide that's a little bit more rigorous, also with metadata. Y'all know, for those of you into all that, that's a lot of work that we're just in sort of stage one. It's good, but we got a lot more work to do, okay? Is it?
Okay.
There you
go. Might have to do the chat box on the
other. Okay, thank you, see? My 3-year-old could've got that. She really good, but she's good at all this stuff. Y'all know what I'm talking about.
I've used this before.
So here's the tool. So what you have is, here are the categories. So here's exposure category, here's some of the layers, an exposure category, pollution burden, not an air toxic cancer risk, or sorry, has index as I talked about before. Then you have environmental effects. Here's the layers that are in the environmental effects subcategory. You have sensitive populations. So what's interesting about this, and why it's relevant, you want to bring in actual health data. You want to bring in actual health data. For those of you who may remember about the that we've had a few bills that we tried to get passed in Annapolis. Senator Benson tried to get the cumulative impacts bill passed in, was the 2014 session. There was no health in it. We modified the bill in 2015 to bring in more health, to bring in the Maryland Health Improvement Health Disparities Reduction Act and bringing health data actually through the health enterprise zones. The bill then passed then, and in the 2016 session, the bill got watered down to focus more about community engagement related to traffic around these facilities. And that bill was called the Reduce Act, reducing environmental degradation in underserved areas through community engagement. I came with the acronym. That's probably why it failed. But the whole idea is, with those bills and why this discussion is important, there's been a lot of discussion in this state about how do you define environmental justice and how do you visualize environmental justice. With this tool, we're getting the right platform and the right IT support, we no longer have that excuse. We had a lot of discussions with MDE, and for those of you familiar with the Commission on Environmental Justice and Sustainable Communities, about what is environmental justice? Well, if we have, you know, this number of black people, this number of poor people, well, if we have this number of white people, this number of black people, and it's all this stuff, and to me, it was more of a delaying tactic. But now, since we use the Cal Enviro Screen model, we have a tool that has that can fulfill that utility gap, that has the utility that we need to actually visualize areas that may have EJ concerns that then we could target when it comes to zoning, when it comes to policy, when it comes to the eco district, which I didn't say. Remember in Bladensburg, I mentioned the EBD, the Environmental Benefits District. Bladensburg actually has an eco district. And the reason I want to highlight real quick, the plan to extend the facility, EMCO facility, is incongruent with the eco district. But to make the eco district actually work, we have to concretize that in our comprehensive plans. Okay? That has to be concretized in comprehensive plans. The use of this tool has to be added, integrated into our comprehensive plans. And just for your own reference, you may have seen a document that says the Prince George's County Environmental Justice 2025 plan. That's a document that we developed at the University of Maryland. Not saying it's an official document of the county. The whole idea is it's a framework, it's a blueprint that county agencies can develop to address environmental justice concerns in this county. In that document, we focus on lead, we focus on water quality, we focus on food insecurity, we focus on air pollution, and we focus on zoning. We highlight Bladensburg, we highlight Brandywine, and we mention tools that can be used like this tool, and we also provide recommendations and metrics. How do you know what you're doing is working if you don't have metrics? You have to evaluate it. So in that document, we have a list of recommendations and metrics for all of those five things. And that's something that as a School of Public Health, as a university, we can be more of a partner with our agencies to help bring in health, provide the technical expertise that's needed when it comes to decision making. For example, there was a bill that recently passed in Annapolis that the county is going to now have an environmental justice commission. The role of the commission is to study environmental justice issues. I think that's a waste of time. You have a School of Public Health to study environmental justice issues. The commission should be used to provide recommendations about what EJ issues should be addressed and the accountability to make sure they are being addressed. We don't need more studies. We got people good at doing studies. Academics, we love doing studies. We need folks who are going to take that work and make it walk and talk. Right, and going to translate that to action. That's what the commission should be used for. Okay, I just want to highlight that that document can be shared. I know I have talked a lot. I gave you a little bit of a moosh boosh, right? Is that the French term? Little whatever, little bite with this. But I'm open to giving a separate training session on the tool. Okay, we can do that at another time.
Sure.
And I'm also, as I said, open to sharing the 2025 plan and having a discussion of how we can integrate some of the elements of 2025 plan into the zoning rewrite. And also sharing the Environmental Benefits District report. How can we integrate this Environmental Benefits District report into our zoning rewrite? How can we introduce it, add it into our comprehensive plans for the county? These are things that, because we bring in equitable development and we bring in health together, as I showed you on these slides. So I am out of gas. I will end there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Any good questions?
I just mentioned traffic, that's all.
You mentioned traffic.
Yeah.
But there are, you mentioned you're also working from the positive perspective as well. And so there are solutions potentially to change some of these, specifically on major commuter routes and things like that to really improve those. what kind of legislative leadership do we need? Have your students gotten to that, using that data to really, as you say, make it walk and talk? I love that expression.
Yeah, so we do have collaborators in the School of Architecture. So Willow Among Lung, she does some work with the, what's the coalition? Not the Purple, it's the Purple Line Coalition?
It is.
Yeah.
So she's done some work with the Purple Line Coalition. So the National Center for Smart Growth, she's affiliated with that center. So they've been doing a lot of work and working with the Purple Line Coalition and doing an evaluation of the Purple Line. And you think about the Purple Line, if you look at the our metro system, right, it's highly segregated, right?
Yeah.
When you think about economic segregation, you look at, you overlay the line, you had like, remember I said the census data? Yeah. And look at it, you know, you can see where lines go and then where lines stop and where we don't have lines. So the Purple Line in many ways is a solution, but when you think about transportation, you also had transit-oriented development. But remember, transit-oriented development could be a good thing and also a bad thing, because it can also lead to what? Gentrification, if done in the wrong way, right? So you have to, so that's why the equitable development framework has to be always at the front end. So you apply those principles, you can think about equity. Equity has to be, you can't do equity on the back end, it's too late. Y'all know that.
Absolutely.
It's too late. So TOD is part of it, Purple Line is part of it. And I also think, you know, with our new district council coming in, and also our new executive coming in, right? These are discussions that could be had around transportation. But I think the Purple Line is a good thing, but honestly, from an environmental perspective, I think it's a short-term solution. You have to make sure you have more economic opportunities where people live. So in Langley Park. So it's, yes, it's gonna be easy for people in Langley Park to get to the jobs. But remember I said about suburbanization, why don't you bring the infrastructure back to people? At the same time, make sure they can still afford to live there. We have affordability crisis in the county. You know, we have affordable housing crisis in the county. And I think, and Fatima knows this, I critique the, what's the plan? Is it the 2035 plan?
Mm-hmm.
When there's language in the 2035 plan that sounds like we want to preserve single family housing. Sounds like you don't want to have people, that language to me means you don't want to have other types of housing. Mm-hmm. So you go, there's language in the 2035 plan. So we want to afford single, we want to preserve single family housing. That to me is like code. You know, that means you're not supporting other types of housing. Okay, so how do we balance out those housing needs in the county with our economic development needs? And I think transportation is a big part of economic development. Okay.
Any other quick questions?
I have a lot of questions, but I'll talk to you later about it, because you need to be educated a little more about the geographies and so on.
Okay.
In the county, so I'll talk to you later about it.
Cool.
Just wanted to bounce off that 2035 plan. That was done at a time when we were, that was our thing, single family homes. And since that time, we are in a townhouse glut now. I mean, we are out of control with townhomes. Our planning as a whole, it just doesn't get listened to. The master plans, the plans we put in just don't, they're good suggestions. And I've been here 47 years and watched a lot of these suggestions and watched areas, watch ghettos be built, slums be built, watch places that were supposed to be the million-dollar home area and then be surrounded by, and put in floodplains.
Mm-hmm.
And I've seen it all. And to watch this, it's then have a county executive who says continuously, we gotta get away from a residential tax base running our county, but again, build so many more residential town homes that's all we have. Building right up one of these Brandywines and Fairmont Heights, putting new homes into where these people. Brandywine is a socioeconomic development hazard. It's a disaster. It's not that it's waiting to happen, you're just watching it. Camille and myself, we watch it go. It's blowing up in front of everyone's faces, but no one can see it. We see it. We see how bad it is down there. And Brown Station Road. We smell Brown Station Road.
Yep.
I live 4 miles away. I smell Brown Station Road.
But it's been sunset, right?
Yeah.
So what does that mean for when it comes to waste management in the county?
We have one of the best in the country.
What do you mean?
Waste management?
The whole
But if you live in their facility, they probably have a different. They may have a different point of view if you live near the Brown Station.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, living near Brown Station, that area, Brown Station Road, you can smell or feel the effects of Brown Station Road
through Perrywood, all down 202, all through Largo,
sometimes
all around, all down here. Croom gets it almost every day. It skips us the way the air flows. It hits Croom.
So
really,
so my question is on Brown Station real quick. Has Brown Station impacted property values? Has anything been done to show any data on changes in property values and anything like that? Because I didn't talk about this. That's another implication of these uses. It's not just the health impacts and exposure. It's what it means to property values, and also what it means to other developments. So, because remember, say it ends up being, well, some people say, well, like attracts light, so we have to build these type of facilities. We have to build a fast food restaurant by another fast food restaurant because nothing else wants to go there. Or we have to build a pawn shop by another pawn shop, a liquor store by another liquor store. And maybe that means you have to do conditional use permits or some other type of thing to change that, right? And so it doesn't have to be the way it is just because it's been that way. How can we use planning procedures and things in the code to modify the code to over time remove some of those things that have been grandfathered, like MCO, and bring in one of these other things that would actually make the community ecosystem a healthier ecosystem?
Yeah, I think it was with Brown Station, it was addressed some 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. And they feel that, you know, that's it. But there's no air monitoring or anything going on around there to deal with anything there.
And that's the important thing about land management because of landfills. It could be, as you said, it could be a well-run and one of the best in the country, but if somebody worked in North Carolina, there's a landfill in a community in Orange County, North Carolina, that was the same labels given, but we saw high levels of VOCs that was impacting the local community. So when you think about overall impacts, it may have been minimal, but for people who live nearby, they have been exposed to levels that were above some of the PEL, the permissible limits, right? So, but that's why you have to have monitoring to know. And then you have to be able to do some modifications in relation to the management of those facilities. And then over time, you know, I think what I'm trying to say is, if we look at our community's ecosystems, what can we do to modify? And then how can planning help with that, right? And then think about what are some of the consequences if things don't go well. And so we have to have, you know, plan A, plan B, and plan C, and some mitigation in place to address some of those issues. Go ahead.
Yeah, sorry, they're going to tow my car in about 8 minutes. So I just have one quick question. Yeah. I have a lot of questions. The widening of 495 with the toll lanes, it's now being discussed. It's not the county planning department, but it's a great concern for the Institute of Economic Justice. And I think the comment period on the alternatives, the deadline is the 27th of August. Are you bringing to bear any of these tools?
They,
commenting on that, on all these proposals?
Can be. Am I personally? No. Can other people? Yes. Yes. Okay. I mean, I would like to, but as Fama said, I can only do so much. So, but to speak to the issue of 485, I think just in general, and speak to your question about transportation, and getting to Al's comment, I think part of the issue is we need to have monitoring. So we don't have any baseline data. And you know, with 495, they did an EIS. There was no health impact assessment because under NEPA, we're not required to do health impact assessment. So to address that, we had to have some type of county. Again, you have, so just a question. I know it's a state, federal, right? It's state and federal. What role did the county have, and was that requirement, did the HAA ordinance kick in? Should have it kicked in? If it should have kicked in, why didn't it kick in? So that's a question for those of you who work in this department. Because I think that you do have an ordinance that could be applied to that. I'm not sure about the jurisdictional issues, right? And so if it's a federal, well, we don't have to do this, but Title VI comes to play, right?
The problem is the politics of it is that we want it because it politically looks like a good idea. The Sierra Club can work with a community to pull this data together, for example, because the politics of the county may not necessarily go in that direction.
Yeah.
So if you're really affecting communities, I mean, I don't know that we can always depend on our elected officials, even at the local level, to do that, the work that's necessary to do.
So just as a suggestion, maybe there needs to be, again, I'm not saying there should be more commissions or anything, but what, because, you know, we end up having like, what's the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. I mean, maybe y'all know sci-fi. Watch that movie. That movie. If you watch the movie, you know what I'm talking about. This is bureaucracy on top of bureaucracy on top of bureaucracy, basically. But if there's a technical advisory commission that can provide some input and decision making like this to make sure HIA is done, to make sure the community is involved at the beginning, the process is going to be impacted by that use. Yeah, that to me would be useful in example 495, but also in other examples too in the county.
The point is just that sometimes the politics are really the place that to deal with it, because the legislative process isn't necessarily going to work. It has to become a political issue.
But the politics don't. That means we have to engage and inform our politicians, and that should have been some of that. Those questions should have happened when people were running for positions, and they still are running, right? And so, do you have an agenda? What's your thought on this? Do you have a plan? Mm-hmm. And then, just like with anything, hold them accountable to the plan. But that's going to be more of us being more civically engaged and going to those meetings and not just letting our proxy group, Sierra Club is a really good organization, but the actual stakeholders live in the community. When they have the time, because they know people are working, the meetings are during the daytime, we have to find ways that they also can, their voices can be uplifted in the process too. I know y'all are tired of a lot of talking. Any other questions?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.